box set. Please welcome the Sneaker Pimps.
Keep me down. together when you prayed. You'd wait forever, just another fragile angel heart falling down on lead wings.
When we started on Becoming X, it was basically me and Liam in the bedroom. So, and we'd never really been in bands before that.
Just bedrooms.
Yeah, so we were sort of messing around with production techniques and a bit spotty and a bit geeky. So we're never really into that sort of side of things until we made the album, and then we realised that we had to go out and promote it, and there were sort of pressures to go in at the deep end and perform live. So. Initially, I don't think we were ready for it, but now we just love it. It's great.
I don't think we ever really expected a huge amount of success. Certainly when we started making music, we were doing white labels, little dance records, which were selling 2,000 or 3,000 a go. So really, the jump from one to the other was quite unexpected. It was we really thought it was going to sell about 10,000, and then we were going to get on to the next record. Yeah, but look at us now. That's great.
I mean, sort of from the beginning, that was our ethos, was to keep changing and sort of do small projects and move on to the next thing. But it just got a bit out of hand. I mean, that's one of the reasons for this change, you know, for the change in vocal style. Because we always wanted to do that and keep things fresh and exciting for us, because, you know, we're just not into that formula thing.
Yeah.
drunk, out of reach. So action fears can last, never missed. Did you preach, you teach, did I learn?
Album probably took around a year of sort of locking ourselves away and being hermits and struggling. But it took a while. It's sort of group therapy, really, when it came down to it. But it was a good time. We didn't really listen to anything else outside the studio, which is good sometimes. It's bad sometimes as well. It is distinctly different. The obvious thing being the male vocal, but there are sounds sort of deep rooted in the music which it still just saw Sneaker Pimps. It you can tell straight away. I mean, if you couldn't, then you never really liked it in the first place, or you didn't understand it in the first place. So.
Still nothing comes to mind.
like you want them to mine. Read your future in the magazine. Set your stars for clues. Read your future in the magazine. Tells you what to lose. Just to find yourself. Place like
tuck me down, safe and sound, too strung up to sleep.
On the singing duties has been quite a task. It started off being a bit of a nightmare because we were sort of all geared up for it, and then I think I thought, what the hell am I doing? But now it just feels so natural. It just feels really comfortable.
I think the biggest difference I think there is that live it seems a lot more I kind of enjoyable in a way, or less intense, less dark. I think when it's to do with the introspection of a record and what you play on a CD in your bedroom or on your headphones, it's kind of quite a difficult record in a way. But live, it seems to take on even though it's the same music and the same sounds, it's a totally different thing. It's about there's a theatrical element, there's a entertainment element which isn't there on the record because they're two different things. I think they both survive equally.
Mm.
At the time we started, we were determined not to be Britpop, and that, I think that was quite a crucial thing. Mm. And I think, if we're talking about when we started as a group, which would have been sort of like 95, 96, I think, we're probably influenced by people like Nick Drake, Kraftwerk. I mean, people from very sort of vastly different fields. So kind of the sonic stuff that Kraftwerk were doing mixed with the pure songwriting of Nick Drake. Mm. Joe was always into kind of indie guitar bands. I was always a bit of a jazzer. So it kind of came from
Miles everywhere. Period, 71 to 74.
69 to 74.
69, 74. Get it right.
Damn it.
Sugar.